Time. God be for us, who can be against us? Amen. We can live in boldness in this world. Amen, amen. As our ushers are helping us, praise the Lord, we'll receive this evening's offering. As you're preparing to give your offering, we do have a couple of needs we need to take before the Lord again. Remember Wesley Poole, involved in a very bad accident and continually needs your prayers. And also Jesse Frazier is in need of prayer. You need to remember those needs. If you have a need, you can represent that by the uplifting of your hand. Let's go to the Lord in prayer right now. Let's believe for him to do a work. God, we are so grateful that we're able to come before you tonight with our requests. God, I pray that you would move in a marvelous way over the needs that have been spoken to this congregation. Lord, I pray you'd send your healing virtue. Lord, also I pray that you'd touch every need that was simply represented by a hand. Let your healing virtue flow, and we promise to give you the praise, the glory, and the honor for it. In Jesus' name we pray, amen, amen. I will make an announcement after service. Our young folks getting ready to go to youth convention in just a couple more weeks, and they'll be doing a meal. It's going to be taco soup, and the dessert will be ice cream and a drink, and that'll be $7. So for any of you who can or will, we ask that you'd go down and support our young folks immediately following service. Go down and be involved with that. We want to welcome everyone here to Bethlehem Church. As I look across this congregation, I do see several guests that we have here tonight. We want to especially welcome you and let you know we are thankful that you're with us. Bethlehem Church, can we welcome our guests tonight? Let them know we appreciate them being here. Amen. Thank you so much for taking time to be with us here tonight. I'm going to ask that if you are able that you would march as the ushers lead you. Bring your offering tonight as the ushers lead you, and bring it as unto the Lord.
Hey! Oh, Whether I'm happy or sad,
give him praise tonight. Go ahead and give him praise tonight. He's worthy. He's more worthy than your sports team. He's more worthy than your favorite politician. As a matter of fact, he's the only one that's worthy of your praise. So why don't you give it to him right now? Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Hallelujah to the Lord Most High. Hallelujah to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Oh God, we praise you. God, we worship you. God, we praise you. It's good to be in the presence of the Lord tonight. It's good to feel the Holy Ghost in this place. If you don't feel the Holy Ghost, it's not this music team's fault, and it's not God's fault. The Bible says, break up your fallow ground. If you're not feeling the Holy Ghost, you've let your heart get hard. And you need to break it up a little bit tonight and start praising God and let him do a work in your life. God won't break up your fallow ground. The prophet of God said, you break up your fallow ground. Don't wait for God to make you praise him. You make yourself praise him. Somebody do it right now. Somebody ought to do it right now. Somebody ought to overcome their carnality. Somebody ought to overcome their bad spirit and just give God praise right now because he's worthy. Oh, yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise tonight. Brother Perfecto, I want you to help me. This is more yours than it is mine. This certifies that Chanel Polanco was baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ Wednesday, the 2nd of November. Amen. Isn't that exciting? I like giving away baptism certificates every week. Praise God. That's right. Give the Lord praise. Give the Lord praise tonight. Thank you, Jesus. As you're standing, we're going to go into the word of the Lord very shortly. Amen. Brother Carson, I saw Brother Carson. It's so good to see you tonight. Amen. If I'd have known he was going to be here, I'd been here, but I'd have been listening to him preach. Amen. It's good to have Brother Carson with us tonight. Always a pleasure. And all of the saints of God, all of our guests, thank you so much for being here. Can you let our guests know how much we appreciate all of them being here tonight? Amen. Amen. And next Sunday night's going to be a great night. Brother Bill Parkey, a dear friend of mine, pastor of the Pentecostal Church in Memphis, is going to be preaching Sunday night service. And he plays the banjo and all kinds of other stuff. And I'm going to try my best to get him to bring as much as he will. And but we're going to have a great time next Sunday night, my good friend, Brother Parkey, here in the presence of the Lord. Amen. I'm so thankful to be back. I got in just a little while ago. Had time to get a shower and get over here and pray. I was preaching last night in Mannheim, Germany, and I left my hotel at the equivalent of 10 o'clock last night for you, at your time. I don't know how that time change did with it, but all I know I've been up a long time. And they were taking me to the airport this morning on the Autobahn. There's no speed limit on the Autobahn. They said, you can sleep. And I closed my eyes, and then I opened them, and I peeked, and they were going somewhere around 160 to 170 kilometers an hour, which is around 100 miles an hour, and it went up from there, I think. So I just closed my eyes and trusted God. Amen. And here I am in the moment, in the twinkling of an eye. Amen. I'm glad I'm in an apostolic church tonight. Where we preach and teach the apostles' doctrine of repentance and water baptism in Jesus' name and the infilling of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Just a few weeks ago, I was 60 feet below ground level, just outside the city of Rome. And I was walking the narrow passages of the catacombs where persecuted Christians were buried outside of the city walls. Here in these deep underground tunnels, Christians gathered to mourn their martyrs as they who had been killed for their faith in Jesus Christ. Christianity was against the law in the Roman Empire at that time, and under brutal persecution, the martyrs found ways of identifying themselves with fellow believers without raising the attention of the Romans and the authorities. One common way that they did was to draw what is known to us as the ictus symbol. It is the symbol of a fish that you see on the back of somebody's car sometimes. Some people say, I remember one time somebody had a honk if you love Jesus bumper sticker, so I honked and they gave me a one finger wave back. It's the way some Christians are. Not real Christians, but some Christians. But what they would do is if they thought there was a possibility they were with a believer, they would draw an arc on the ground. And if the other person was a believer, they would finish with an opposing arc that made the symbol of a fish. And that way they knew that they were talking and dealing with another believer. The symbol of the fish became the symbol for Christianity. In a time when the symbol of the cross and other things related to Christianity were dangerous, the fish identified you as a Christian. The fish was the way of saying that you had faith in Christ. And all over these catacombs, these symbols deep underground are carved or painted into the death chambers of these ancient Christians. And I want the world to know that I'm one of them. I'm not ashamed of being an apostolic Christian. I'm not ashamed of my praise. I'm not ashamed of the name I've been baptized in. I'm not ashamed of the Holy Ghost I've got. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. The book of Exodus chapter 15. Book of Exodus, chapter number 15, verses 22 through 25. And then one verse in the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter number 6, and that would be verse 9. It's a message I've worked on for a long time. Somebody said, I have worked on two or three other messages for tonight. But over the last few days, this message stayed in my mind for this service. And I pray the Lord will help me preach it. I prayed tonight. I prayed all before service and all during service that God would help me say what He wants me to say. And that God would help me not to say what He doesn't want me to say. Sometimes that's more important than saying what He wants you to say, is not saying what He don't want you to say. I want to be directed by the Holy Ghost, and I want a move of God. So Moses brought Israel from the Red Sea. And they went out into the wilderness of Shur. And they went 3 days in the wilderness and found no water. And when they came to Marah, they could not drink of the waters of Marah, for they were bitter. Therefore, the name of it was called Marah. The word Marah in Hebrew means bitter. And the people murmured against Moses, saying, "What shall we drink?" And he cried unto the Lord, and the Lord showed him a tree, which when he had cast into the waters were made sweet. There he made for them a statute and an ordinance, and there he proved them. There was a tree that turned bitter water into sweet water.
Now I'm going to read another verse that at this time would seem to have no association at all with the passage I just read. 1 Corinthians 6:9, know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Fornicators, idolaters, adulterers, nor effeminate. Everybody say effeminate. Nor abusers of themselves with mankind shall inherit the kingdom of God. I'm going to preach for a while about polluted water. Polluted water. The bitter waters of Marah. And the people murmured against Moses, saying, what shall we drink? And the Lord showed him a tree. Lord, I ask you, God, to help me tonight. I've asked you from the moment that I've come into this place to anoint me to preach, God. And now I ask you to anoint the ears of this congregation to hear not only my words that I say, but God, that they would hear what your Spirit would say. Anoint our ears to hear and anoint our hearts to receive. Anoint our minds to comprehend and receive it. And God, help us not to be hearers only, but doers also. And I pray, God, that you would confirm your word with signs following, and let there be a blessing of your name and Spirit on the hearts of your people tonight. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Give the Lord a praise tonight as you're being seated. Quaint little town of Swanton is nestled in Franklin County in the far northwestern corner of Vermont. The village lies on the banks of Lake Champlain, which was an important location during the Revolutionary War, primarily known for Fort Ticonderoga. After the Revolutionary War, the town receded into the backdrop of the national consciousness and became just another small town in rural America. That's just the way that the 6,427 souls who make up the population of the little town, that's just exactly how they like it, with their collective anonymity enjoying the beautiful countryside and peace and quiet. Left alone to their hunting and fishing is exactly what they wish for. In the wintertime, the stately silver maples, lanky and bare, stand on the frozen grounds of the Missisquoi National Wildlife Refuge. The river is home to bass and muskrats and beavers. In the fall, more than 20,000 migrating ducks will converge here. And in the summer, one of the refuge's rarest species, the spiny soft-shell turtle, will bask and forage on the gravelly beaches and sandbars. It is an outdoorsman's dream. This wildlife refuge is one of the most productive and pristine wetland ecosystems in Northeast America. But over the last few years, scientists have found an abundance of fish with bizarre abnormalities that have caught the eye and troubled the minds of some of our best biologists and conservationists. These scientists from the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service and the U.S. Geological Survey. Studied fish in 19 wildlife refuges across the country. And they came to an astonishing conclusion that 60 to 80% of all male smallmouth bass they examined in this refuge had female egg cells growing in their male reproductive organs. The problem goes beyond the area around Swanton, Vermont. Over the past decade, feminized male fish have been discovered in 37 species in lakes and rivers throughout North America, Europe, and other parts of the world. Intersex males don't look outwardly any different from the normal males. Federal scientists uncovered the condition by accident in the Chesapeake Bay watershed in 2003. They were conducting an examination to determine the causes of smallmouth bass die-off when they found male fish with female egg cells. In a follow-up study, they found these conditions in more than three-quarters of male smallmouth bass caught in parts of the Shenandoah and the Potomac rivers in Virginia and West Virginia. Don Tillett, a U.S. Geological Survey toxicologist, said that the condition is definitely not normal. The presence of female eggs in the male reproductive parts indicate a kind of hormonal confusion that scientists call endocrine disruption. Everybody all right? I know I've used a few terms that make people uncomfortable. I'm the one having to say them. So you can relax. Evidence suggests that this condition in fish may be the result of exposure to contaminants that have been put into the water that mimic the effects of estrogen on these male fish. Worldwide, these conditions have occurred in an array of aquatic animals, including alligators and turtles and frogs. Listen to this. 85% of smallmouth bass in these wildlife refuges were affected to some degree. 91% of largemouth bass in some sites were affected. Other species of fish, the roach, the sole, and the Chinook salmon, to name a few, are showing similar effects. 100 rivers from around the country have shown the same circumstances. It's been seen in the Mississippi River, the Rio Grande, the Columbia Rivers, as well as the aforementioned Potomac and Susquehanna Rivers. Outside of Swanton, Vermont, on the banks of the river, everything looks normal to the eye. Frozen marsh grass crunch underfoot. A woodpecker flies among the wayward branches of an uprooted tree. A muskrat lodge made from bulrush and cattail, they dot the landscape. When winter's ice thaws, it will teem with wildlife. But below the water's surface, everything is changing. One scientist said the fish weren't dying. He said from the outside, they didn't look any different. The outside looked like they were supposed to look, but inside there were serious issues. In one study, estrogen levels were added experimentally to a control pond. With just traces of estrogen present, the population of the fish totally collapsed to near extinction. In two separate experiments, it was found that 76% less offspring were produced. Extrapolated forward over time, it will be near devastating to our national fisheries and wildlife refuges. If they don't find a way to get the fish right on the inside, there will be no future generations. I'm going to say that again. If they don't find a way to get the fish right on the inside because they look right on the outside. If they don't find a way to get the fish right on the inside, there will be no future generations. Amen. God understands. Now look, I want to clear some stuff up first before I get into this, because I don't want to forget and not come back and make it right, okay? And what I'm getting ready to say is very important. I want to be very clear that I thank God for the women in our church. Every husband better say amen right now. We would be in a mess if it wasn't for the hard work and prayer and worship of the godly women of this congregation. Thank God for every one of them. All right, I'll preach a long time. If you're going to sit there, I'll preach. I'll preach all night long. God understands the beauty of a holy, godly woman. God thinks so highly of women that he typed his church as a mother and as an elect woman. With that being said, I will tell you that there is a crisis of manliness in our world. If you men don't say amen, I'm going to think I got a problem here. I'm telling you, there is a crisis of manliness in our modern world. In our modern culture, there is a feminization that has been happening to the males of our society. This is not going to be popular on the internet here in a few hours when it goes up, but it's still the truth. Homosexuality and gender confusion are the result of a feminized and sinful society. Amen. A few years ago, there was a phrase that some started using in regards to men having a feminine side. I will tell you, I don't have a feminine side. God designed me with two masculine sides, the left and the right. Well, glory to God. Hallelujah. It's all right, I'll settle in. Women are emotionally and biologically predisposed to nurturing. But in a push for advancement, some are assuming roles in society that have not traditionally been held. I have offended women around the world by using the term ma'am when I address them. I have offended women around the world by opening a door for them to go inside a building and standing aside while they go in. I've been told you make me sound old when you say yes, ma'am. And I just tell them that's just a sign of respect for your feminine side. Instead of being viewed as a sign of respect, it's taken as an offense in our culture. Make no mistake about it. I am not advocating the barefoot, pregnant, and silent viewpoint. I'm saying that God created men to be manly and women to be feminine. That's God's plan. I know it's not real popular these days. It's sad you can't really get too many good amens in an apostolic church when you say it. But it's still the truth anyway. At the same time that we have seen a rise in masculinity among women, we've seen a notable increase in femininity in men. Our culture is feminizing before our eyes. Praise God. I'll have to be honest and say that I struggle with femininity in males. It's not politically correct, but it's still the case nonetheless. And I've noticed a trend that when something becomes acceptable in society, eventually the church's stance on the issue begins to soften. Very often when we see something in nature that's been altered or changed by men, there's a mirror image of it happening in the spirit realm. What we see in nature is a reflection of a spiritual issue. Man has changed the environment of lakes and rivers and streams and polluted the waters to the point that fish are being feminized and the population is in danger. And likewise, we see in the spiritual realm the dangerous manipulation of our spiritual environment and our morals that is changing Christianity from the inside out. Okay? Hallelujah. These changes in the spiritual environment are feminizing the male population of many churches, displacing the God-given roles of maleness in the home, in society, and in the church. Well, praise God. Can you amen me, please? I'm going to ask at least our preachers, like, amen me. Don't sit there and stare at me. We've seen these effects throughout history in many ways. In some cultures, the husbands are spiritually apathetic, spiritually lazy, sometimes absent from church altogether. And consequently, the wife has to be the leader of the home in the spirit. But a Christian family is not designed the same as a worldly family. Amen. And likewise, the nearest thing to the relationship between God and the church is a relationship between a husband and a wife. That's why Satan fights marriage and family so hard. If he can get an inroad into the family, he has an inroad into the church. Satan hates the church. Therefore, he hates marriage and he hates the family. God has ordained a spiritual order for the family in the Bible. The Bible way is not politically correct, but it is still the right way. Amen. In this generation, preaching biblical principles about marriage and family makes people mad. The fact is that Christians were created to live in a particular way. Am I preaching all right, Brother Carson? Am I preaching the truth? Amen. I think for the most part that we still look okay on the outside. There's some people in the church who are going to be worldly no matter what is preached, no matter what you say. They're going to do what they want to do. You can't help that. If God can't help it, I sure can't help it. But by and large, we've tried to stay the course in the core of the church. But just because everything looks normal on the outside doesn't mean it's normal on the inside. The enemy isn't going to bring this church down overnight, and he knows it. Therefore, the enemy of your soul and the enemy of this church wants to pollute the spiritual waters, wants to cause a gradual change to take place on the inside of us so that it will sterilize our ability to spiritually reproduce. He wants to sterilize your praise so your children won't know how to worship. Amen. Can I preach my heart to you? I'm going to do it anyway. It's a shame, man, I'm preaching to you tonight. It's a shame that this side was full and this side was full and this was empty. You men need to step up, because if you don't, your little boys are never going to know what it's like to be involved in the work of God. You ought to be ashamed of yourself. If you've got talent and you're not using it, you ought to repent right now. It's an embarrassment to God's gift to you. All right, I'm going to preach. I might close my eyes and preach like it the whole night, but I'm telling you, it's time that men step up and be apostolic and quit being feminized by the culture. If your wife out worships you, you've been feminized. If your wife out prays you, you've been feminized. You're the leader of your home. Step up and be the man you're supposed to be. Can I get an amen from somebody? I'm preaching the truth to you. You may not like it. You may not like it at all. But that's because you've got a problem on the inside. If you don't like what I'm preaching, it's because you've got a heart problem. It's the word of God. It's the truth. It's the book. And whether you like it or not, it's forever settled in heaven. There are carnal forces at work in this world that wants to change the church from the inside. from the heart. People who look Pentecostal but don't care a thing about lost people. Just soon let people go to hell because they're not the right color or from the right place. They'd never say it, but it shows in their attitudes towards people who don't know God. People who look right on the outside but never go to the prayer room. And when they do, they stare at the wall and never go deep in prayer or go around talking to somebody and bugging somebody that is trying to pray. People who look holy on the outside but never really lift their hands and worship God. Never come to an altar. Never help pray a sinner through. Never come help somebody find God. Always ready to go home. Always ready to leave. Can't get an amen out of them. Can't get a hand clap out of them. They look right on the outside, but on the inside they're full of dead men's bones. We need to repent. We need a move of God. We need God to bring us back. Our water's been polluted. If you can sit still in a Holy Ghost environment, you've got a heart problem. Oh, God. Lord, help me. I've already spilled half my water. You people know I don't preach this hard very often. If you've been around me very much, you know I have to be feeling it in the Holy Ghost. Or I wouldn't be bringing it this hard. But I'm telling you, something has to shake it up. You get more mad about an election than you do about your kids not coming to an altar and praying. God help us. This is what's important. What happens out there, we can't change it. But we can change what happens in here. You ought to hit an altar and say, God, save my family. Save my family. Save my boys. Save my girls, God. Save my family. Save my family. Your vote needs to be cast for God. Look right on the outside. I understand the enemy wants to change the appearance of the church on the outside. Trust me, I get the pressure all the time. He hates our biblical holiness standards. He doesn't want our men looking like men and our women looking like women. He doesn't want us to refuse the decorations and ornaments of this world. I understand the devil doesn't want that, but he also knows that he's not going to destroy it overnight. So he pollutes the water to slowly change us on the inside. If he can get your worship just a little bit colder today than it was last week, just pollute the water just a little bit. If he can get your prayers just a little bit more distracted today than they were last week. If he can get you just a little more disconnected from the preaching today than you were last week. He'll like nothing more than to pollute the waters, because he knows that every time he puts a little more pollution in the water, he's changing you on the inside, making you carnally minded, more concerned with life on earth than life in the spirit. There is an anointing that comes from heaven that we need God to put on our hearts. We need God to convict us of sin. Sin is a plague on this generation. Sin is a plague on this world. We can't play with sin. Amos 5:15 says, hate the evil and love the good. Establish judgment in the gate. It may be that the Lord God of hosts, oh God, it may be that the Lord God of hosts will be gracious unto the remnant of Joseph. How many want God's grace for your families? I want God's grace on the remnant of the church. God, put your grace on this church. God, put your grace on this church. But you know, when it comes, he says, hate the evil and love the good. We have to get a hatred for sin in our hearts. Not a hatred for sinners, a hatred for sin. Psalms 97:10, ye that love the Lord. How many love the Lord? How many love the Lord? Come on, how many love the Lord? The Bible says if you love the Lord, then it says hate evil. You can't love the Lord and like evil too. You can't have a love affair with the world and a love affair with God at the same time. You can't play with the devil and love God at the same time. The Bible said, ye that love the Lord, hate evil. Ye that love the Lord, God, teach me to hate sin. Don't let me get so used to it. Don't let me get so used to seeing it in my world that I don't lose my hatred for sin. The fear of the Lord, Proverbs 8 and 13, the fear of the Lord is to hate evil. You have to get a hatred for sin in your hearts. Listen, we see it. The Bible said Lot's righteous soul was vexed from day to day. How is his righteous soul vexed? The Bible said by seeing and hearing. The more he saw it and the more he heard it, the less it bothered him. To the point that he could move right in the middle of it and not be affected. It never disturbed him anymore. I'm going to tell you that this world is pumping sin in front of your eyes on a moment-by-moment basis. It's in all the advertising. It's in everything in this world. The music of this world. The movies of this world. The television shows of this world. All the stuff that this world tries to put in your mind. It has one goal, and that is to desensitize you to the effects of sin in your world, to where you can see it and it doesn't bother you anymore. But God, help the church to still have an aversion towards sin, that we don't fall in love with our sin. Teach us, God, to have convictions on our heart. Godly convictions. Godly convictions. You can't be soft towards sin and be a godly Christian. I'm almost done, I'm pretty sure. Over the years, I've preached grace and mercy so much, trying to help people overcome their past, trying to help people, keep people from, can't even talk, shame, ruin their walk with God. I preach grace and mercy, trying to let people know you can get out of any mess you got into. But I wonder if I've preached it so much that some of our people have lost their aversion to sin. I'm here tonight to say that there needs to be a feeling of disgust that comes in our heart towards sin. You're the gatekeeper of your heart, and you need to be the one to close the gate. Your pastor has a responsibility to preach the truth to you, not to win a popularity contest. I realized a long time ago I'm not going to win a popularity contest. I'm not called just to be a nice guy. I'm not called to babysit Christians who refuse to grow up. Galatians 4 and 16, Paul said, am I therefore become your enemy because I tell you the truth? Are you sitting there mad at me because I preach the truth to you tonight? Your pastor's not your enemy. If I'm telling you the truth, I'm not your enemy. I'm the best friend you have right now. I'm fighting for your boys and girls. I'm fighting for your kids and your marriage. I'm fighting for your walk with God. I'm fighting for your prayer life and your worship. I'm fighting for your soul right now. I'm trying to shake somebody out of a dead place and get you moving towards God, because I see a change happening on the inside. I've been in prayer this week. There's several spirits that are attacking this church. Some of them I can't preach about yet because some people here like them too much, so I can't challenge them just yet. But there are a couple that I have permission from God to deal with right now. And one of them is that spirit of hell that wants to make your worship dead and dry. Amen. That's a spirit from hell that likes dry places where he can manipulate your joy. There's a demonic spirit that wants to take the joy out of your walk with God. It's more than you just getting disinterested or discouraged. It's a demonic force that's trying to drag you away from God. And you need to resist it and fight it. The word enthusiasm comes from two Greek words, the word in and the word theos. Enthusiasm in the original language is theos,
God and in within. Enthusiasm is God within. Amen. So I've come to tell you that if you've got God within you, you'll be enthusiastic about prayer and enthusiastic about church and enthusiastic about worship. David said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. He was enthusiastic because he had God within. If you can't get excited about God, you got to say, God, fill me with the Holy Ghost one more time. Fill me with your spirit one more time. Shake me up, God. Shake me. Come on, I wish somebody would say it right now. Shake me up, God. Don't let me get cold. Don't let me get cold. Shake me up. Shake me up. Don't let me get cold, God. Don't let me get cold. Don't let me get cold and distant. Don't let me get dry, God. Don't let the fire go out. Help me to have theos within. God within is enthusiasm. Oh, God. Hallelujah. If you love your families, if you love your children, if you love your soul, if you love God and his church, then find a way to stir yourself up to serve him. Amen. Amen. When you sin, you bring a reproach on God and his church. You risk your relationship with your family. You may recover and make it, but what about the life lessons that's been implanted in our children? When you miss church, you're teaching your family that unfaithfulness is the right way to live. And you're saying what that bishop and what that pastor preaches isn't really that important. It's not as important as the game I want to stay home and watch. It's not as important as me sitting in my recliner on Wednesday for an extra hour and a half. Well, glory to God. I know it's all right when I'm preaching on somebody else, but when I'm preaching to you, you want to just throw it over your shoulder. I'm telling you that you're teaching your family what's important and what's not important. Your actions speak louder than your words. You can't say you love worship and sit like a bump on a log in a worship service and your kids take you serious. You can't say you love praising God and then never lift your voice and never lift your hand and think anybody knows. I'm telling you, you're teaching lessons by how you act. How you act. It looks all right on the outside, but there's a problem on the inside. There's polluted water. When you go your own way, you're teaching your family that living what is preached from the Bible is not important. That you can do what you want and it's okay. You're establishing a spirit of rebellion in your household that is a stronghold of Satan. And you're bringing spirits into your family and church and exposing your children to those same spirits. You guys don't ever want me to go back to Germany, do you? As a pastor, I get tired of excuses. Some people always have something to blame for their problem. There's always some traumatic event that gives them an excuse to do what they do. But the real truth is that people who like sin, sin. And people who don't, don't. God has called us to serve him and to live for him. God gave the instruction to Adam about how to live in the garden. Adam's role was to be a spiritual leader. He was created first. God has determined that the spiritual order of the home is for the man to be a leader. A man should lead his family in prayer. Oh, I just realized I forgot to start my clock. Oh, I got lots more time. And I think I need it. The man should be a leader in faithfulness. And a leader in worship. And a leader in holiness. A leader in giving. A leader in being involved in the ministry of the church. A man should be a leader in soul winning. Brothers, you're called to lead your home. Your masculine role in the family is to be the leader. And if you're not fulfilling your masculine role, you have been feminized by a wicked generation. It doesn't matter how masculine and macho. Macho is not even a word hardly anymore, I don't think. It doesn't matter how masculine you act and how manly you are. If you're not spiritually leading your family, your soul has been feminized. Straight talk, but true talk. Here's the man's role in the family. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived, neither fornicators. We know that. Nor idolaters. We know that. Nor adulterers. We know that. Nor effeminate. Nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. God help us to fulfill our godly roles. Amen. I read somewhere in a commentary that often when there were feasts in Israel in the times of the judges, and there would be times of dancing in worship, it was not led by the young single men or the young single girls. It wasn't led by the wives and grandmothers. It was the fathers and the grandfathers who would step out first and begin to worship the Lord. And then they would be joined by their wives and their children. The man's role was to lead the family into worship, not wait until the ladies warmed it up. It's time that we push back against the devil's desire to feminize your worship. How are we going to do it in this generation? I'll be honest with you, if I'd have preached this message 15 years ago, this church would be standing on their head. Am I telling the truth? If I'd have preached this message 20 years ago, this church would be going bonkers. But we've become so accustomed. Look, I've only been preaching 3 minutes and 24 seconds, and you're already wore out with me. But we can't have old-time revival until we get back to old-time principles. And part of those principles is that we need to step up and not let this culture affect how we react to the Spirit of God. We are not denominational. We are not denominational. We didn't come out of Rome. We didn't come out of Rome. We didn't come out of Nicaea. We came out of an upper room where there was Holy Ghost and fire and tongue talking. And if we're going to be the church in this day, we still need an upper room with Holy Ghost and fire and tongue talking. And I'm going to tell you, men, we need to get our praise back. Some men need to get their shout back. You need to get your dance back. You need to get your leap back. Some men hadn't talked in tongues. You ought to open your mouth right now and give God a voice and shout out with the voice of triumph. And take it back. Take your spiritual masculinity back tonight. I am a man of God. I am a leader of my home. I am a worshiper. I am a worshiper. I am not created to be dead. I'm not created to be dry. I'm not created to be quiet. I'm not created to sit back. I am a worshiper. That's what I was made to do. That's what I was created for. That's what God wants out of me. That's what He expects out of me. The Father seeketh such to worship Him. We're in a wilderness, folks. We're in a wilderness. We're in a wilderness. And the only way we're going to get water in the wilderness is we got to get a tree and put it in the water. We got to get back to the cross. We got to get the cross back in our water. We got to get Calvary back in our water. We got to think about the cross. When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all that he's done for me, my soul cries out. Hallelujah. We got to think about the cross. We got to think about Calvary. We got to think about Jesus. Praise him. Praise him. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in the firmament of his power. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise ye the Lord. From the rising of the sun until the going down of the same, the name of the Lord. There's never a time for dead church. There's never a time for dry church. I am a praiser. I'm a worshiper. I don't want the polluted water of my generation to change me on the inside. I don't want to drink the water of this world and let it change me on the inside. I might look right on the outside and be dead on the inside. God, turn my soul around. Turn my heart around. Turn my life around. Turn my family around. Turn my spirit around. Turn my mind around. Change me. Change me. Change me. Put the cross in my mind. Put the cross back in my water. Come on, somebody ought to praise him. Somebody ought to just break out in an old-fashioned apostolic praise. That have been in church a long time, and he grinned and thought they hadn't moved in a long time. That one hadn't talked in tongues in 10 years. That one hasn't stood to their feet and jumped before the Lord in the presence of the Lord in years. Uh-oh. I think it's time to give the devil back some of his own medicine. I think it's time somebody to shake off all that old stuff off of you and go ahead and give God a praise. It's going to feel uncomfortable at first because it's been a while. But once you get, it's like riding a bike. Once you do it, you can't hardly get stopped because it's so much fun to find yourself in the presence of the Lord and in the glory of his goodness. Come on, I challenge you to shout like you hadn't shouted in a while. I challenge you to give it up for God like you hadn't done it in a while. You don't have to do it by yourself. Somebody will do it with you. Come on, it's time to praise God. It's time to worship God. It's time to shake off some of that polluted water. Hey, it's heavenly, holy, Holy Ghost outpouring.
I want you to know that I will.